Dear participants, on behalf of the Guru Nanak Center for Research, Guru Nanak College Autonomous Chennai, I welcome you all to the day 4 of the International Workshop on Recent Trends in Technological Advancements in Aquaculture and Fisheries. Today's presentation is Use of Molecular Markers to Resolve Taxonomic Ambiguities of Species with Special Reference to Indian Mangrove Mud Crabs by Dr. Anup Mandal, Project Manager, Central Aquaculture Genetics and Central Aquaculture Pathology Laboratory, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, the R&D Center of EMPEDA, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, Chennai, Tamil Nadu. I welcome the resource person, Dr. Anup Mandal, sir, our principal, Dr. M.G. Raghunathan, sir, vice principal, Dean Research, Dr. J. Jayanti, ma'am, deans, heads, and faculty of various departments of Guru Nanak College, and also I welcome from the bottom of my heart the galaxy of participants from across the globe for today's program. Now I request Dr. Venu, Assistant Professor, Department of Advanced Zoology and Biotechnology, to introduce our chief guest. Sir, please.
Good evening, one and all present here. It is great privilege to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Anup Mandal. He is currently working as project manager at Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture in Sirgali, Tamil Nadu, which is an aquaculture technology incubation center of Marine Product Export Development Authority under Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. He is in charge of NABL Aggregated Central Aquaculture Genetics and Central Aquaculture Pathology Laboratory of RGCA. Dr. Mandal has more than 23 years of research experience in the field of population genetics, molecular genetics, DNA fingerprinting, disease diagnostics, selective breeding, and laboratory management. He completed his PhD work at National Bureau of Fish Genetic Resources, Lucknow, in the field of fish population genetics. He received several fellowships and awards and worked as a research fellow in esteemed institute like SIFI Mumbai, Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun, and Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science, Lucknow. He published several research papers in high-impact international journals like Animal Genetics, Gen, Molecular Biology Reports, Biochemical Genetics, Mitochondrial DNA, Journal of Applied Ethology, Journal of Selfish Research, etc. He published more than 500 unique gene sequences in NCBI, Gene Bank, and has several book chapters and articles in national and international proceedings. He supervised more than 25 students for the postgraduate project thesis. He is one of the member of Research Advisory Committee of ICAR, NBFJR, Lucknow. He visited many countries for professional reason and represented India in international project planning meeting at NACA, Bangkok. And as a member of working group from India for the State of the World Aquatic Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture for FAO, among other noteworthy contributions, his team from RGCA only reported first time that Indian coastal water having only two mangrove mud crab species by Scylla serrata and Scylla oliveacea on the basis of molecular genetic studies. I welcome Dr. Anup Mandal sir to take over your session on use of molecular markers to resolve taxonomic ambiguities of species with special reference to Indian mangrove mud crab. Once again, I welcome you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Venu sir. Now I request our resource person, Dr. Anup Mandal, to present his presentation. Sir, please.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon to all of you, and thank you, Dr. Venu, for your nice introduction. And I would like to thank Sardar Manjit Singh Nair Saab, General Secretary and Correspondent of Guru Nanak College, Dr. M.G. Raghunathan, Principal, Dr. J. Jayanti, Convener and Dean Research, Dr. Mahendra Kumar Sir, and all other faculties and staff of Guru Nanak College for providing me this opportunity to present our research work, particularly mangrove mud crab research for you. And I came to know from Dr. Venu and others there are lots of participants from all over the world watching or listening this presentation, and maximum of them are students. And this presentation particularly I made for students. I think it will be helpful for you. If it become helpful or useful for your future research, it will be my great pleasure. So today's topic, use of molecular markers to resolve taxonomic ambiguity of species with special reference to mangrove mudcrabs. So I am representing Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, which is an aquaculture technology and incubation center of Marine Product Export Development Authority, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. We are involved in development of new technologies for diversified aquaculture or export-oriented aquaculture species, and also develop such technologies which are relevant to sustain the ongoing export-oriented aquaculture system all over the world. And my laboratories, the Central Aquaculture Genetics Laboratory and Central Aquaculture Pathology Laboratory, they are all, both of the laboratory are NABL accredited, and our genetics laboratory is the first and only aquaculture laboratory in the country who got NABL accreditation in the field of biological testing. So with this background, now I am going to present my presentation outline is, first I will talk about the species. What is species? Because we are going to talk about molecular identification of species. So first we need to know about species, then why it is difficult to identify species. I will talk about that also. Then molecular techniques, why I use to choose this technique, that I will talk. Then some molecular markers, again I am repeating that markers will be RAPD, randomly amplified polymorphic DNA, DNA barcoding, ITS, internal transcribed spacer, then PCR, RFLP. Restriction fragment length polymorphism. There are lots of molecular markers, but I am going to concentrate on three or four of these. Then of course, how our RGCA team resolved the taxonomy ambiguity of mangrove mudcrab, that I am going to share details with you. Then let us first know what is species. And I am sure everybody listening today, this presentation knows about this. A biological species is a group of organisms that can reproduce with one another in nature and produce fertile offspring. This is very important. Species characterized by the fact that they are reproductively isolated from other groups, which means the organism in one species are incapable of reproducing with organisms in another species. And this species is the basic term in taxonomy, systems of taxonomy. But interestingly, there are more than 20 other different species concept. And this I wanted to emphasize. There are so many definitions of species, like ecological species, genetic species, and as I told, biological species concept. So many species and people have described them differently. Like biological concept, I will talk about genetic concept, which also similar to biological concept. And amount of genetic difference between the population of the species, it actually estimate. And this definition I took from Nature and Britannica, Encyclopedia Britannica. Why I'm telling this? Because students, particularly if you go through our websites and other things, you can get lots of definition. There is no dearth of definition of species. And this is one of the reason why we actually in dilemma, how many species are there on the earth or in the ocean. I think it is not only a big question, it is a great embarrassing question for us. Why it is embarrassing? Because recently in 2010, in his paper, Tropical Arthropod Species, More or Less, which published in Science, Dr. Robert May, he actually noted that if alien visited our planet, one of their first question would be, how many distinct life form or species does your planet have? And he also noted that it would be embarrassed by the uncertainty of our answer, because we don't know, total uncertainty. Because in number, if you look at the number, somebody will tell that is ranging between 5.3 million to 1 trillion. Now, million means 10 lakhs, okay? That is 53 lakhs to 1 trillion. Trillion means million, million, 10 to the power 12. So you see the difference. You see the range. It is huge. Isn't it embarrassing? We don't know how many species are there on Earth. And if we go through the literature, what I find till today, that a total of 1.3 million species have been identified or described. I'm talking about identified or described, not anticipated. But one research publication came in August 2011 by a group of scientists led by Hawaii University. They estimated there is 8.7 million species are there in our planet, on our planet. Now, that means if I consider 8.7 million and we described only 1.3 million, then also only 15% of the animal existing we know, and others we don't know. Still we don't know. And if you consider 1 trillion, it's just unimaginable. I don't know where we'll be landed up. Even 1% also till now we don't know. So this is the important. This is the important why we need to know what is species and how to identify the species. Now today I am going to talk about mangrove mud crab. And our students, those who are working in aquaculture or fisheries or geology or biology, you know, Arthropoda, there is about 1.2 million species representing almost 86% of total animal known to us. Now, out of this 1.2 million, nearly 1 million is insect species. There are molluscans, which is about 85,000, chordates, about 61,000. Of course, plants represent nearly 2,92,000 species. I'm talking about known species only. Now, every year, new species are turning up and at the rate of nearly 18,000 species per year. That means every year, people are discovering or identifying nearly new species, almost 18,000 per year. And I have one very interesting data I will show you. You see, I have result from Barcode of Life data system, that is called BOLD. Students, those who are interested in barcoding, today I will talk about barcoding also. You can note down this website, BOLD, Barcode of Life data system. It is very good website and you need to know this. So last year, almost 1 year before, 24th September 2018, I have gone through this website and I find out that there are 2,81,956 species of animal, plants, fungi, and proteids are barcoded. Means animal submitted, barcode submitted, gene sequences submitted in the BOLD system. The number was nearly 2,81,956. And that was included 2,09,675 arthropods. Why I make this? Because arthropods is a huge number. They are actually 86% of the animal representing. So out of 2,81,956, 2,09,675 was arthropodan species. And just 2 years before, in 2016, I actually searched and I find out it is increased by 23,750 numbers. That means 2016, the number was nearly 2,60,000 near about. And after 2 years, it is increased by 23,750 numbers. Now, what about today? Yesterday, I find out that species number with barcodes are 3,15,507. And you can see from where the sample collected, all these dots, red color, or yellow colored dots, they are all the species and the places from where the samples has been collected and submitted to BOLD database. And you can see that increase by 2 years. I have data 2016, 2018, and now 2020. And 2020, it increased by 33,000 numbers. That means every year, almost 15 or 16,000 animals number are increasing. Why increasing? Because we need to know, and we don't know how many species, which are the species like that. Now, if you see the Arthropoda, then Arthropoda recent data means yesterday data I collected, and I find out the 2,47,295 arthropods are there. And you can see very well, even India, if you look here, all the dots are representing the people are submitting data on arthropod DNA sequencing to Bold database. So this is World database, and you can very well go through this. And what about Decapoda? Because I am talking about mangrove mud crab, which is coming under Arthropoda, and then Melacostaca, then Decapoda. In that Decapoda, the number of Decapodan species with barcode available, 5,648. So if I go back like this, you can see how the number is showing in the database. So this is, now we know what is species and how many species roughly. And we know very well now that we even don't know even 1% species existing in the world. You have recorded only 1 to 2% species if we consider our studies, earlier study done. Now question comes, whether it is easy to identify species? That is the question, and that we have to going to answer today. First you look, here one example I have given. It is Lepidoptera, tropical Lepidoptera, and there are 10 different photos are there. And my question is, how many species? And those who are watching or those who are listening my presentation, you may be thinking so many numbers, I think so. Somebody 10, somebody 5, somebody 1, somebody 2. But I can tell you sure, it is very difficult to identify them only based on the morphological character, isn't it? Now, you see the next one. Few days back, I was working with Dr. Santanam, Professor Santanam from Bharatdarshan University. He is a renowned scientist for copepods. And we are doing DNA barcoding of copepods with him. And when I was interacting with him, we find out more than 13,000 species of copepods are known. Unknown, we don't know. Known species are 13,000. So this many species, and they are looking like, almost similar to each other in many cases. How to identify them? Then I'm talking about mud crab species. Mud crabs coming under mangrove crab. So mangrove mud crab, correct? Mangrove crabs, there are nearly 300 species of mangrove crabs are available. The mangrove crabs means the crabs which are, living in mangrove estuaries areas or mangrove forest. So out of that, these four species of mud crab, all over the world, people have reported. And India, there are many reports are there. Somebody told 4, somebody 3, somebody 5, somebody 1, like that. And even before this presentation, I was talking with Dr. Jayanti Madam, who is also working lots with mud crab and all. And she also told there are lots of confusion regarding mud crab species name, whether Trancobarica is there, whether Serrata is there, whether Olivacea paranomosen is there, like that question are going through here and there. So today, I'll try to explain that. Now, if I look into, not into morphological things, if I look into food, then again, it is more difficult. Sometimes you go to restaurant and you ask for one fry or something, like I have shown you here, for one species. For example, valued species. Like you go for kadubamin or sibas, and they will give you one this fry with less valued species, like local tilapia or something like that. The value difference will be there. One may be 25 pound or dollar or rupees, another may be 4 or pound or dollar or rupees. So how to identify them? They are looking almost same. You cannot identify. After cooking, it is very difficult because the morphological character will go. So here also, question of identification is coming. Not only that, now, because of COVID-19 related situation, everybody knows about our COVID virus, coronavirus, everybody knows. And many people, even they are not from the science background also, they are also talking about how many mutants, how many sequences, all these things. So identification of a big thing, a plant or an animal moving around, is rather easy than that of identification of the species, which are very microscopic, ultra microscopic, or like a virus or bacterial things. So it is not easy. Identification species is not easy, and identifying life further challenging because there are several stages of life: larval stage, semi-larval stage, adult stage, like that. So just you look this picture very carefully, you look at this, you know, identifying life, the real challenge. Because as I told you earlier, somebody told 1.3 million, somebody told 1.8 million. If we take it 1.7 million known species are there, then how they are looking? They are looking like insects, almost, you know, taking all the places. Now, if you consider even 10 million, I'm not talking about 100 million, I'm not talking about 1 trillion. If I'm talking 10 million, then also this much area, you know, it will be question mark. We don't know. And if we talk about 100 million, you know, you can give the answer yourself. How good we are in the taxonomy, or how good we have still know about our species. It is rather very, very, very small. Now, you see this picture. They are world-renowned traditional taxonomists, and they are the backbone, you know. They are the backbone. They are working day and night. And here some pictures are there, some butterfly pictures. And you know that insect diversity, I told, it is very huge. Now, if like these dedicated taxonomists are there, and their number is 10,000 taxonomists, and if I consider 10 million species are there, how much time it will take, you know, to identify all the species? If they work day and night without any rest, it will take 600 years. Isn't it crazy that even if I am going for 10 million only, then also it will take 600 years to identify the species with renowned taxonomist, and there will be, you know, very minimum we came to know about the species identification. So what is the solution? The solution is, you know, molecular taxonomy. That is the only solution, and all over the world, all universities, colleges, students, they are also looking for molecular taxonomy and using molecular markers. So molecular taxonomy, we are using molecular markers. Two things, new things, just now I told you. One is molecular taxonomy, another is molecular markers. Now, I am telling you again, traditional taxonomy is must, because when your sample is coming to lab, that name, what you are giving the name, our lab people, they will only use that name only. For example, you are collecting blood from tiger and collecting blood from one human, and that blood will be in a tube only. And if you are naming the tube tiger and human, and by chance, if you just misplace, then what will happen? Our lab people will think human blood as tiger blood and tiger blood as human blood, and result will come opposite. This is just example I am giving. And if you think about small species, rather unknown species, then chances of error will be very, very high. So traditional taxonomist much more required. Traditional taxonomy is the backbone of the, you know, all species identification system. But to make it quicker, to make it, you know, realistic, to finish as much as possible the number, we need the help of molecular taxonomy. So that's why molecular taxonomy or molecular markers are required. Then what is molecular marker or genetic marker? Particularly students, those who are watching this, you think it is very simple. Don't take it very complicated. Like you are using a pen or marker for marking something, correct? If you have a note and with marker, you are marking. This is also marker, same type of marker, but only difference is it is molecular marker. So how this molecular marker we are getting? We are actually getting molecular marker because all organisms are subject to mutation as a result of normal cellular operation or interaction with environment leading to genetic variation, which we call polymorphism. Because of polymorphism, there is difference between you and me. We are all same species. Those who are watching today, we are all same species. We are Homo sapiens sapiens, but there is difference. Somebody from Ghana, somebody from Nigeria, somebody from Uganda, somebody from India. So we have different genetic makeup, and that genetic makeup is because of polymorphism. So that polymorphism, because of our DNA, ATCG, adenosine, cytosine, thymine, guanine, how they are arranged, how mutation is happening, all these are coming over there. Those who wanted to know more about genetic marker or details about genetic marker, they can future contact me also. There is no problem. But for today's lecture, I make it simple. A DNA marker technology is a technology using DNA or part of a DNA or a fragment of a sequence to mark something, to identify something, to note something, that is DNA or genetic marker or molecular. So what is molecular or genetic marker? It is a part of DNA. It may be an allele, it may be, you know, cytogenetic marker or gene product, something like that, which will be using for marking or tagging some particular animal or particular sample. That is genetic. Now, why genetic marker? Because genetic marker could be used for identification, detection of, as I told you, food. You gone to restaurant, you pay more, but they have given you less money food, that is seafood fraud or normal food fraud or discrimination of aquaculture stocks and so many others. So many others means population structure analysis, comparison between hatchery and wild stock, assessment of impact of natural population. All biology students, you can do n number of research work using molecular. I am repeating n number of research work. So many research work. Phylogenetic study, population structure analysis, monitoring of inbreeding, identification of genetic loci, then, you know, breeding program. In RGCA or MPDA RGCA, we are using genetic, you know, quantitative genetics for selective breeding program. And I am looking after lots of selective breeding program in tilapia, monodon, all these things. And they are, we are using this molecular marker or genetic marker. So not only for DNA identification, not only for species identification, it could be used for several other objectives, to fulfill other objectives also. Now, there are several numerous types of genetic marker. Somebody knows about this. Many of you know about this. Alloy marker, random amplified polymorphic DNA or RAPD, mitochondrial DNA, internal transcript spacer, restriction fragment length polymorphism, randomly repeated DNA or microsatellite, then single nucleotide polymorphism, express sequence tag, barcoding, so many. And if you ask me about the resolution power means which marker you will be using for your work, which marker you will be using at your laboratory, it totally depends on their resolution power and what you want to do. For example, you want to do population structure analysis. Like there are several populations, like Tamil populations, Bengali populations, Marathi populations, Kerala populations. You want to do some genetic work on that, go for microsatellite. It is better than RAPD. But if you go for species identification, RAPD may be quick and easy to do. And like that, there are every molecular marker have different, you know, positives and drawbacks or negatives. Like, for example, if you want to go from Chennai to Delhi, how to go? You can go by several ways. By train you can go, by flight you can go, by four-wheeler you can go. So many means. Somebody want to go by walking also, he can go. But thing is, yeah, how much time you have, what is the importance of your work, how much money you have, whether you need comfort or not. So many problems are coming, isn't it? Depending on that, you are choosing, because time and money is very important. Here in molecular marker cases also, same thing apply. First, your lab, you have to use molecular marker depending on your, you know, depending on your requirement and depending on the resolution power of the marker, correct? So now I will come to my main topic, that is how we resolve the taxonomic ambiguity of MARTCRAM. First, I use sequencing method, that is mitochondrial DNA markers, and that is barcoding. We did barcoding. That I will tell you little elaborately how to do barcoding with mitochondrial DNA gene sequences. And then PCR-based molecular markers also in our lab we used to solve this ambiguity. And we used random amplified polymorphic DNA marker, that is RAPD. Then internal transcript spacer or ITS and restriction fragment length polymorphism, that is RFLP. All these markers we used to solve the taxonomic ambiguity of MARTCRAM. Here I want to mention one thing. In particularly students, you know, when you are trying to solve any problem like taxonomic ambiguity or population genetics or any other, you know, problem where you need to use molecular marker, it is always better go for multiple marker, not single marker, because single marker may not be always perfect. Sometimes it may give you perfect result, but to make it confirm, to make it concrete, to make it further accurate, you need to use multiple molecular markers. So what we did to resolve taxonomic ambiguities of mud crabs, we used multiple molecular markers. And here are the markers we mainly used to resolve this ambiguity. Now, I'll talk about this DNA barcoding little more. What is DNA barcode? You know, earlier I told you, we are using a sequence, DNA sequence. So it will be a particular sequence which will apply to the sample, and we can find out which sample is belonging to which species. I can tell you like this. You see, it will be easier to understand. In our normal barcode system, that is our universal product code, there are 10 possible numbers. You know, 10 possible numbers means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 0. If you calculate 1, 2, 0, so it is 10 possible numbers. And position, how many positions? 11 variable positions. Position means, for example, here you see 167. Some number is there, end 167. Now you can change the position between 6 and 7. So it will be 76. Or here it may be 2, or here it may be 0. Now, universal product code, you know, anywhere you go, you purchase an item, and there will be this universal product code or barcode. And there will be computer, somebody sitting, they will be scanning, and they will tell which is the product, from where it came, how much, you know, cost, all these things. That is universal product code, correct? With these numbers, they can, you know, actually identify billion of items. So if you do this, you know, permutation and combinations, there will be lots of items, billions of items you can identify using these 10 possible numbers and at least 11 variable positions. Now, what about DNA barcode? DNA barcode, we know, we have only 4 unique states, mean unique number. Here, I'm comparing with that. 10 possible numbers, here, 4 unique states. Which are those states? A, P, C, G. Which are ATCG. And if I talk about position, what is the position? It is like that. You know, some sequence, no, DNA sequence, it will be like ATCG, GCTA, ATT, GTC, GCGA, like that. So if you start from ACT, then it will be start from 1, 2, 3. Like that, if you amplify a particular gene fragment, which is having 700 base pair or 697 base pair, that means you have 697 positions. Positions means 4 states, A, T, C, G. But how many positions? 697 positions. Now you calculate how many species you can identify using this DNA barcode. Millions and billions of species you can identify. I think it is clear to you. Here what we are doing? We are using 4 unique states, that is A, T, C, G. And how many positions? It may be 679 position, depending on what fragment of the gene. How many gene? Because our DNA barcoding gene, COI, universal barcoding gene, that is nearly 675 to 690 base pair it is normally coming. But if you are taking total COI, it will be 1200 base pair sequence. And in our lab, we are using total COI gene, which is actually nearly 1200 base pair size. So, what is the target region? You know, mitochondria. I talk about mitochondrial DNA barcoding gene. The mitochondria is a circular, you know, DNA genome. And in this circular genome, there is nearly 22 genes are there, like cyto-B, NB6, COI. And in COI region, there will be, you know, two part. One is COI1, another is COI2. Normally, if you go through literature or papers, all DNA barcoding, people are using COI1, that COI1 gene. So this is the target region. Which one this target region? This COI1 gene is the target region. And somebody is using both COI1 and 2 like us. So if you do that sequence, and if you go for matching with reference sequence, you can very well identify a species almost 98% cases. Now, which will be the barcoding gene for others? Now you know COI, it's not applicable for 100% species identification. Although it is almost 95 or more than 95% species could be identified using COI gene. For fungi, for example, those who are interested to work on fungi or students, you have to use ITS gene. That ITS I will talk about. Some plant also separate type of genes like, you know, RBLC, chloroplast ribulose, then MT, MATK, you know, mutares K, like the genes are there. Animal, almost all animals, 95% animal will be, you know, identified by CUI gene. And there are lots of positives for CUI gene. Those who are more interested in DNA barcoding, you can go through properly DNA barcoding things in future also. This is just basic I am giving. Now, while I started, I have given you one question. How many species that Lepidoptera? Now, morphologically, it was very difficult to identify. We were thinking 10 species, 5 species. Somebody was thinking maybe 3, 4, 2. Now, with DNA barcode, what is the result? You see, very interesting. With DNA barcode, it was found that it is only one species. When all our sequences are matching, after DNA extraction and amplifying of the targeted gene, when we reference we match, we find out it is almost one all same gene. So how the different species? Then the question gone to biologist. From geneticist, it's gone to biologist. Then biologist gone back to nature. And they find out all these animals, they are product of the same species. Now, this is the mother species. And from that only, all these 10 animals are coming. How peculiar you see. They are all looking like different, but their mother is same. That means that 10 species is actually one. And this is the beauty of DNA barcoding. And this is the beauty of molecular identification. So you may tell there are 1 trillion species are available. But how many actual species? You have to use basic traditional taxonomy with DNA barcoding or other molecular markers to identify the species. And this paper was published by Dr. Hebbard, Paul Hebbard, and he is the father of animal DNA barcoding. And I had opportunity to meet with him and had several meetings with him because of, you know, barcode in India. And we find out that almost 95% species could be able to identify with DNA barcode easily with COI gene. But one point again, I am telling you to remember that is traditional taxonomy is the basic. It has importance. It is the backbone. But with DNA barcode, it will give the support. It will give the supplement. And then only we came to know actual species. Now, another marker I used, that is RAPD, randomly amplified polymorphic DNA. This RAPD is a short, you know, fragment. This RAPD primer is actually a single primer. Those who are students from biotechnology background or those who are using this RAPD, they know. But many of you may not be using RAPD marker. For them, I'm telling just for PCR, polymerase chain reaction, you need 2 primers, 1 forward primers, 1 reverse primer. But in case of RAPD, only 1 single primer, that also short primer, 10 repeats, it will be using 10 oligotides primer. It will be using, and single primer will be working as forward as well as reverse. Technique wise, if you want to know, you can contact me later also. Here I want to tell you, this RAPD is a very good marker for species identification. It is very good marker. There are several advantages. Because when you are starting working in molecular markers in your laboratory, in your college, you will face problem with money and equipment. You know, sequencing and all these things is very good, but you have to have money, you have to have the facility, like we have ultramodern facility, but many of you don't have. For you, remedy is you search some marker which is very less, you know, it will take less money and less, only 1 thermal cycle is enough for this. So you can go for this type of molecular marker also. So what are the advantages? It is very fast and economic, as I told you. It is selectively neutral. That is a very good point. Then it is having high power of resolution, polymorphism detection. And it is, you know, used by many countries, many people. But some problem also there. The problem is reproducibility and ambiguity. What is that? It requires some expertise. It is easy. It is easy, but it requires some expertise. It is required some people who already worked in RIPD, who knows in and out about RIPD, so that that problem will solve, that reproducibility problem will solve. In our laboratory, we are using very efficiently this marker, and I will show you the picture how beautifully we are getting the results. So RIPD, normally for species identification, is a very good marker. Then I told about ITS, and I also told you, ITS is very good for fungi identification. You know, ITS is internal transcript spacer, and many of you may know or don't know about this, but this marker having several advantages. You know, this ITS region is mostly, most widely sequenced DNA region in molecular ecology of fungi and recommended as universal fungal barcode sequence. This is like animal, we are using COI gene as universal barcode, and for fungi, this ITS is used as universal barcode. So this ITS marker also very useful, and people are repeatedly or routinely using this marker for their study. Again, I am telling students, don't worry about this marker, how they work or what are they. If you really work on ITS marker, you have to go through literature and practical. And for practical, we are here, we can help you to use this marker for your future studies. Another interesting marker is restriction fragment length polymorphism. That is, from the name itself, you came to know restriction. So we are restricting something. What we are doing? We are amplifying one DNA product, and using restriction enzymes, we are cutting that DNA product. And you all know that restriction enzymes will cut DNA in a particular position. That means the sequence of DNA, there will be A, T, C, G, something like that. For example, I have a sequence where I have A, C, T, G, G. Somebody have A, T, G, C, D. So some difference will be there. So if you know the difference in our sequence, you can use software to find out the restriction enzyme which could cut that DNA fragment. There are lots of restriction enzyme software, identification of restriction enzyme software, like, you know, cutter B, web cutter, or, you know, sequence cutter, like that. So many are there. So you have a sequence. Today also you can try. After this lecture presentation, you can go to Google to download some sequence from NCBI. And that sequence you can put in wave cutter software. There you can see which enzyme will cut, which position it will cut. So enzyme will work as cutting a particular sequence position. For example, some enzymes cutting T position. So it will cut only T, not A, not C, not G. So if somebody having T, that sequence only will cut. Cutting means from one cutting means two fragments. Two cutting means three fragments. Like that it will come. Uncut means no fragment, only one will be there. So this restriction fragment length polymorphism also we used for our MODCRAB, and I will show you how the result looks like. Now, how to solve this problem? In India, you know, many people, as I told, they told there are three or more species are there, and all over the world, there are four MODCRAB species are there. One is Scylla serrata, Scylla olivacea, Scylla trancuberica, and Scylla paramomosein. These are four species available in the world. Now, when our work actually, when we started in our lab on MODCRAB, actually we have MODCRAB project. I think Dr. Sammuga Arasu already presented about our MODCRAB hatchery project to you. And there we are doing Scylla serrata. Now, when we start, we thought, why not selective breeding of MODCRAB? So for selective breeding, we have to do population genetic study. So population genetic study, it is prime requirement to know the species correctly or accurately. So when I started collecting samples from various parts of India, as well as from our hatchery, our expert people, why I am mentioning this? Because our hatchery, our people are expert. They know about the species very well. Even there also some problem, because the size and shape of the crab is actually misleading. When it is coming to hatchery, it is a bigger size, more than, you know, 90 centimeter carapace. But smaller size, it is rather difficult to identify, because these crabs are having variation in coloration, size, pination, habitat, etc. So we find out really there is a problem, and we have to solve this problem. Then we go through the literature, and very interestingly, we find out one paper published by Dr. Kenan in 1998, and he published a paper on Mudcrab species identification using molecular markers as well as, you know, morphometry. So I find that paper is very interesting. And when I compare that paper, I find India, we have only two Mudcrab species, not four. No Trancobarica is there, no Paranomocene is there. So instead of, you know, publishing the paper, what I did, I collected samples from all over India. I collected from sample all over India, starting from Gujarat, West Coast, Mumbai, Maharashtra, Ratnagiri, Madgaon, Goa, then Mangalore, Kannur, Kerala, Kochi, Nagarkoil, then up to Sundarban, and then Andaman Nicobar Island. Almost everywhere I visited, myself and my team visited, we collected sample, because we thought we should not keep any, you know, any stone unturned. So what we did, we collected sample from all over India. Then what we did, we used multiple molecular markers, as I told you, not only sequencing, ITS, RAPD, RFLP, and all these things. Then what we did, available literature in India, we classify them into four groups, because in literature they told, if there is polygonal marking all over the body, then it will be Scylla serrata. If polygonal marking not all over the body, then it may be Scylla trancobarica or something like that. If, you know, propodar spine is very sharp, if frontal lobe spine is very sharp, like that, several characters are there, morphological characters are there. So we not neglected any character. We take into account all the characters, and all the collected species we actually, you know, differentiated or, you know, assigned into four groups. So we collected samples from all over India, and when on the basis of morphological character we classify them, we find out majority of the sample as per the morphology, I'm repeating, as per the morphology, coming Scylla serrata. Almost half of the samples were Scylla serrata, only 15 was Trancobarica. Why? Because we consider that character published in the book or literature, that spine will be like this, spine will be like that. And Olivacea also was nearly 500 something, and Paranomocene also we got nearly 70. So you can see, out of 1200, majority of the sample was identified as serrata and Olivacea on the basis of morphological character itself. Other two, like Trancobarica and Paranomocene, because literature they told spination and all these things. Then we followed Stampedor classification, then Cardivel and Srinivasagam, our from India, their class classification, and of course Kenan. And all samples we keep for our consideration. I collected sample from Andaman Nicobar Island, you can see very well, Andaman Nicobar Island, then collected from West Bengal, that Canning area, and you can see all muds are there, because they are putting mud in, this is a different species, not green one, you can see here itself. Then collected sample from Odisha, the Chilka Lake area, then several places in Andhra Pradesh, like Kakinada, Nagalanka, all these places, and you can see the color, so much difference in color and shape. Then Tamil Nadu, lots of places we collected, particularly Parangipetta area, from where lots of literature was earlier published. Then Kerala, several places. All this we collected, and as I told you, there was nearly 1200 samples. Now, first what we did morphometric study, and we find that polygonal marking, they told polygonal marking. You see, in the body, there will be polygonal marking. So we find out that character, partial polygonal marking also we find out different types of, you see, here marking is not there, below marking is not there, and some minimal marking is there. You see, here marking is there. Like that, all different characters we find out in female also, male also, and variation in polygonal marking also we study. This was our morphological analysis, a part of morphological analysis. Then of course, that frontal lobe spine, it is the major characters in literature they will be telling. What is frontal lobe? This area is frontal lobe. You can see one is very sharp, little bit, you know, pointed, another is not pointed. So this is actually, they are telling two species. One is sharp means Scylla serrata or Trancobarica, and down means Scylla serrata or Trancobarica. In literature you go and you can find out this. And otherwise they look totally you know, similar. They look similar. Only this frontal lobe spine. Like that, you can see the frontal lobe spine in magnified position, how it will be look like. You see, it is pointed, and previous slide, it was, you know, not pointed, blunt. Like that, you see, very beautiful picture. It is pointed, it is blunt, and propodous spine. Earlier, it was frontal lobe, now propodous spine. Those who are from, you know, biological sciences, you know what is propodous spine, corpus spine, or frontal lobe. This is propodous, and this is propodous spine. This is very sharp. In some cases, it is sharp. Some cases, it is blunt. So in literature, they are telling one is paramosen, one is olivacea. So like the difference are coming. So we not neglected any suggestion. We keep it as olivacea, and we keep it as paramosen. Like that we did. And you can see different types of, you know, propodous spine. Here you see blunt, here you see pointed, like that we got. Then, of course, this is very important. All students, very important to look at this. There is carpus spine. This carpus spine in green crab, it will be two numbers. You see one and two. This is two number, and here you see one number. This is in brown. It is one. You see green color crab in India, what I find? Two. And in brown color crab in India, I find one. So this is very important. Please note it. And in literature, it is telling if there is two number, it will be one species. If there is one number, another species, so many. So now, after all these things, I have four species. What? Serrata, olivacea, paramomosen, and tankovarica. Serrata, olivacea, paramomosen, tankovarica. Why I am telling? Because I consider all the morphological characters. Now, one very interesting thing. If you see, if I see the ventral side, that is, you know, male and female. In crab, male means it will be like, you know, little pointed. Female means it will be little white. So if it is pointed, that is male, white means female. And interestingly, we find out that what we are telling serrata, it is actually male, and what we are telling tankovarica, it is actually female. Who knows, maybe they are same species, later I will tell you. And same case in olivacea and paramomosen also. In case of paramomosen, we are finding this, you know, pointed, and olivacea, we find it, this is, I mean, male and female. Male, it was like one species, and female like another species. That also I'm going to explain. So this is the summary of the slide about, you know, lobe spines and all these things. Then we did morphometry, and we did not manually. We did how? With digital slide calipers. So there is chances of human error will be less. We use digital slide calipers, and we use internal carapace width, frontal median spine height, frontal width, and other corpus spine, outer corpus spine, inner corpus spine. All this measurement we have taken. Because I told you, molecular identification is fine, but you have to do basic taxonomy or morphometric identification first. So our importance was to do morphometric study very well. And we use digital type of things to reduce the error. And after that, in our lab, we collected sample from our crab species. We have taken little muscle inside, you know, ethanol. And our next was to identify, to extract DNA out of that and do sequencing or other molecular markers. So this was the collected samples in our lab. And this is the barcoding of mitochondrial DNA. What we did, first we amplify that DNA. And after that amplification, we use that amplified product and we use the sequencing. That was a part of barcoding. First DNA extraction, then amplification, then sequencing. So what is the process? Sample collection. In the lab, sample will be collected. Then collected sample will be processed. Then processed sample extract DNA will be there. There will be PCR. After PCR, there will be sequencing. Again, I am telling. Sample collection, DNA extraction, PCR, and sequencing. This is all about DNA barcoding. Okay? Then, which are the steps involved in laboratory? First, you do DNA extraction. Then you do polymerase chain reaction. Use the DNA fragment as per the choice, 16S, CY, whatever, and they do then do DNA sequencing. This is the process. So after sequencing, we did RAPD also, as I told, randomly amplified DNA. Then internal transcript spacer also you used, and RFLP. As I earlier told, we use all these markers. Now, what is the result? The result is very interesting. You see, when I used that morphometric analysis, we find out the cilla serrata and cilla trancovarica. This is cilla serrata, this is cilla trancovarica. Morphometry, I am not talking about molecular. Morphometry, they are showing, serrata and olivis are showing same median. That means they are almost saying they are same species. Then olivacea and caramomosin, they are also, you know, median is same position. That means even if you are doing morphometric character analysis very carefully with the targeted sample and which sample should be targeted like that, your result will be showing there is not four species, only two species available in India, and one group is cilla serrata olivacea, cilla serrata and trancovarica, they are coming in one group, and olivacea paramomosin coming in another group. All type of morphological analysis is showing the same result. You see previous result, another character, this is another character. All characters, whether it is internal carapace length or, you know, width, everything is showing there are only two cluster, not four. Of course, our DNA sequencing result, it is clearly showing there is only two species, not four. Whatever you are talking about serrata and olivacea, they are two different species. And what is we are talking about in India, trancovarica, that is actually serrata, not trancovarica. And olivacea is actually paramomosin. What we are talking in India is olivacea. So India having two species, one is serrata, one is olivacea, like this. You see, only two species. What we are talking about olivacea and paramomosin, they are actually olivacea. They are all coming in the same position. Those who are biotechnology background, they know this is same species. And those who are, you know, cilla serrata and trancovarica, they are coming in the same position. They are also same species. This is our result. You see, RAPD, only two group you can see. Here is only one group, cilla serrata and trancovarica. They are all showing similar type of band pattern. And olivacea and paramomosin, they are showing similar type of band pattern. Not one. So many molecular marker we use, RAPD marker, and it all shows there is only two species. And our ITS, that is internal transcribed spacer 1, that also showing only two, no four. You see only one group, here is only another group. One group, which is cilla serrata and trancovarica. If it is serrata, it will be 1474 base pair, and it is olivacea, it will be 1282 base pair. Like that, all our results shows that it is even RFLP also very good result, only two group. This is one group, this is another group. This is one group, this is another group. Cilla serrata and trancovarica is the same group, and it is cilla serrata. Cilla olivacea and paramomosin is the same group, it is cilla olivacea. Conclusion. What we conclude? We concluded that cilla serrata is actually greenish color. The greenish color sample, what we find out from India, that greenish or dark greenish, that is cilla serrata. And corpus spine, two corpus spine. I shown you the corpus spine, there will be two spine. Corpus means in this area there will be two spine, that is cilla serrata. And cilla olivacea, that is corpus spine only one, and that is metallic brown crab. So if you are getting any mud crab from India, if it is green color and there is two corpus spine, it most probably cilla serrata, and if it is metallic brown, it most probably cilla olivacea. This is the conclusion I told. If it is two spine, cilla serrata, it is one spine, cilla olivacea. Polygonal marking and all, that is not advisable, because depending on the sex and breeding season, that color and spination, all these things may change. The sharpness, that, you know, some is very pointed, some not pointed, all these character may be depending on the habitat, on the season, all these things. So India having two mud crab only, one is cilla serrata, another is cilla olivacea. And this is very important, this study is very important, because whatever you want to do, whether they are propagation, whether they are culture, whether they are breeding, this species identification is must. And till now, we published nearly 40 sequences in NCBI Gene Bank. And there was first four sequences we published from India, which shows cilla serrata and cilla olivacea sequences. And the result, first we published in 2013, there was an international seminar of mud crab aquaculture and fisheries organized by Philippines and India. And I was convener from India for that program. And we published first this result in this mud crab seminar. 22 scientists from all over the world. They came to Nagapattinam district in Tamil Nadu in our office, and this program they participated. We published full-length papers also in Biochemical Genetics Journal, Journal of Selfish Research, Mitochondrial DNA Journal, and it shows that our acceptance of our result. And just before the lecture, I was talking with Dr. Jayanti that now I have submitted another paper of the profile of four marker species. Because after this publication, I got samples from Indonesia, Philippines, Myanmar, and China, all these places. Well, they are actually Karamosin or, you know, Tankuvarika is there. So with more confidence now, I can tell you, India having only two mudcrab species, not four, correct? One is Scylla serrata, which is green color. One is Scylla olivacea, that is metallic brown color. And just before finishing, one recaps. What to do? If you want to do DNA barcoding, students, just collect sample, whether it is crab, copepod, any small ant, or any other thing, earthworm, anything, you collect the sample. Preserve it in 95% ethanol or contact us how to preserve it. After that, you do DNA extraction and you do PCR. PCR with what? Your targeted gene. If it is COI1, if it is, you know, not fungi or other species, COI1 or 16S rRNA or 12S rRNA, depending on your species, you choose the gene and amplify. Then what to do? Sequencing. In our lab, we have sequencer and we are doing sequencing, and very well, we served so many research institutes from and students from India, and we are serving still. So you can contact us also for this sequencing part, and I'll be very happy to help you. Thank you. Thanks for your attention. And thank you again to Guru Nanak College for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful presentation and a very detailed information. We've got a few questions. Shall I read out those questions, sir?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Dr. Bishwaranjan Samantaraya wants to know the total number of species, fish species barcoded in India, sir.
Fish species barcoded in India, mainly done by NBFGR Lucknow, and the details of the fish species barcoded will be less than, I think, 5,000 actually. But if he wants to know exactly details, how many and all, you can go through that BOLD website, BOLD database. The database I have given, BOLD, B-O-L-D, the database, if you search India and fish, all details with sample collected from where, it will be coming. As far as my knowledge is concerned, it is less than 5,000.
Okay, thank you, sir.
But I can clarify, I can give him details also if he can send me mails in future.
Okay, thank you, sir. Mr. Rajshekaran has asked, thanks for tonight's information. He would like to know the distribution of these species in Muthupet mangrove forest, Pattukottai. And he has also told that he's interested to know the suitable species for cage culture there, sir.
Species for cage culture?
Yeah.
Actually, mud crab will not be used for cage culture, but cage culture species will be mainly cobia. Cobia, you know, cobia species will be useful for cage culture. Some people are doing pompano also, that is silver pompano. This type of species you can use, and for that you can contact RGC also, because RGCA, we have project cobia hatchery project and silver pompano hatchery project, where people are particularly CMFRI also doing some work. And NIOT, they are also taking seeds from RGCA for putting into the cages. For cage culture, I think your targeted species should be cobia or pompano in some stint, but never this crab, because crab required mangrove forest area. This okay. Mud crab required mangrove forest area.
Mr. Jagdeep Singh has asked, any potential drawback for in molecular identification?
Pardon, sir?
Jagdeep Singh has asked, is there any potential drawback in molecular identification?
Yeah, very good question. Actually, this is very good question. Molecular identification drawbacks, it depends on the sample collector. For example, if the collector, sample collector is not well-versed with the animal, if he is not at least know basic taxonomy, then what he will do? For example, he gone to forest area or river or lake, and he collected one sample. For example, I'm just for example giving one rohu species he collected, but he identified wrongly. He identified not rohu, he told it is chitala. Chitala Chitala. Now what will happen when he give the sample to, you know, molecular lab, the molecular lab people, they will be treated as Chitala Chitala. So what they will do? They will do DNA extraction and all these things and submitting result, they will submit as Chitala Chitala. So whether it is fault with molecular identification? No, it is actually fault with the basic. That means the source sample is wrong. So if you ask me whether is any drawbacks like this only, sir, only the initial source. If it is problem, then some potential problem is there and it is happening all over the world because people are submitting in NCBI without confirming the actual molecular status. Second is, no techniques in the world is 100% perfect. You know, like I told, COI can do 95% species, animal species identification perfectly, not all, because in case of hybrid, fungi like that, it cannot identify properly. But 95% is not a bad number. Like, you know, ITS, it could be very well used for fungi, some different gene. So my suggestion is, if you want a perfect result, you use more than one molecular marker, including this, targeted genes. Then chances of error will be very, very, very low.
Thank you, sir. Ravi asked, in crab, which variety grows fast and what is its duration of the life cycle?
Okay, this is also another very good question. And I think this question our Dr. Samugarasu maybe earlier discussed. But these two species are available in India, sir. One is Scylla serrata, that is king green crab. Another is Scylla olivacea, that is brown crab. The brown crab, normally you can find all over India, especially I'm telling, in Sundarban area of Bangladesh and India and Gujarat. In this area, there will be only this brown crab, no green crab. That is very interesting. There is no green crab or Scylla serrata in West Bengal or in Bangladesh or in Gujarat, we find out. So because of maybe mangrove forest and other things, that crab will grow only 350 to 400 to 500 gram maximum. But Scylla serrata, it can grow up to 3 to 3.5 kilo also. Because in my personal experience, mm-hmm. when I was working in Andaman Nicobar Island, I collected 3 kg Scylla serrata crab. So it is faster grower and market value is very high. So if you are really going for crab culture, it is always better to go for Scylla serrata than Scylla olivacea.
Okay, sir. Mr. Praveen Prasad has asked, same species have same DNA. What is the effect of biodiversity on species? Does it change the DNA or a new species come? He has asked.
Yeah. This is also a very beautiful question. Actually, we are all same species. The person who asked me the question, myself, everybody, we are same species, we are Homo sapiens sapiens, but we are different. How we are different? Because we have changes in our DNA. How these changes happen? Because your DNA is susceptible to environment. That is called G into E factor, genetics and environmental factor. Just I want to give, if time permits, one example. Time permits, sir, 1 minute.
Yes, sir, please.
For example, if you go to higher altitude area, like Himalayas and all these areas, you can find out people are having smaller hand or, length of their hand and leg will be smaller. At the same time, if you count their RBC in their blood, it will be very high, number will be very high. But for us, for me, or person from in Tamil Nadu, our RBC will be lesser than those people and our length of our hand and leg will be little bigger. Why? Because when you are in upper altitude, their oxygen is less. So your body needs more oxygen. So there will be more number of RBC. In RBC, there will be red blood corpuscle, that is, there will be hemoglobin, and it will make oxyhemoglobin. It will take oxygen and make it oxyhemoglobin. So that is requirement. So our environment required, our body required, so our gene changes. Like that, in any area you will go, depending on the environment, depending on the requirement, everything will be changing. So even though we are same species, but some changes will be there. But again, it is a very good question. Why good question? Because when we are identifying species, we are targeting genes which are not changing much. For example, it will be universal barcode gene area, which will not be changing much in species level. But if we want to know which is a culprit in case of, a murder case, or rape case or something like that, who is the culprit, then we are using DNA fingerprinting and using another marker. So even within the same species, within the same population, within the same family, you can identify the animal or identify the individual on the basis of your targeted gene. So answer is your gene, you are same species, no doubt about that, but different parts of your gene are changing depending on the requirement, depending on the environment, and depending on the other biological, you know, feed and other things, it is changing. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Anulakshmi has asked, if you get a DNA which is not identified in any repository, then what should we do with the DNA or taken as a new species?
Achha, it is also a very good question. It is actually rather very important question, because lot of species will be identified in future and you have to follow a certain norm how to identify the species. I can give you one example. You know, Dr. Ravichandran, he is from Annamalai University department, and he is extensively working on crab, you know, particularly marine crab. And I have very good opportunity to work with him, and lots of sample I did for him, and he find out new species. Now what to do with that? First, when you are identifying a species and you are getting some new clue, you have to publish that in Zoo Taxa or similar type of taxonomical paper. First, you go through taxonomy first, very well study. You find out whether there is any difference taxonomically or not, and you publish that in Zoo Taxa like that of, you know, journals. After publication, these sequences, what you are telling new, you publish in NCBI or Bold database and get the accession number. With these two, one is your Zoo Taxa publication or something like that. Another is with your accession number, like what we did, you can publish a very good paper and you can tell your species is new. But always, it may not be true also. Sometimes you may be getting one sample or DNA or sequence which seems new. That may be because of no people has been done genetic study and they not submitted in NCBI. That also may possible. It may be, you know, morphometrically it is not new, but DNA or sequence level, you are finding it is new. So you have to collaborate that. That is very important. Your traditional taxonomy has to be collaborated first with molecular taxonomy.
Okay, sir. So Musharraf Hussain has asked, what is the time period for Scylla serrata?
Time period means life, you know, breeding cycle you are talking about?
Or, yes, sir.
Actually, there is a time period means two, three different time periods I can tell. One is, if you are doing culture, how much time period for harvestable size? It may be 6 months to 8 months. It will grow 750 gram to 800 gram. That is one answer. Another answer is life cycle. It may be 1 year to 1.5 years for next generation. For time taking to produce the next generation. For human, it is huge. For elephant, it is 12 years. But for Scylla serrata, it may be 1 year. Then third is, how long it can survive in the wild? As my information is concerned, maybe 4 or 5 years it can easily survive. After that, it will go for natural dying.
Okay, sir. Mr. Sajid Sheikh has asked, which Indian mud crab species is less prone to disease?
This is also a very good question. And thank you for this question. Actually, Scylla olivacea is less disease prone to disease, but one but is there. Why I'm telling this? Because Scylla olivacea is burrowing more than Scylla serrata. Means when it will burrow, Scylla olivacea, it will go rather deeper than Scylla olivacea. And Scylla olivacea is very delicate type, not very strong or, you know, ferocious like Scylla olivacea. If one 500 gram serrata and 500 gram olivacea, you put together, means that olivacea can kill the serrata. So that their behavior is like that. And olivacea, that external cell, that is the carapace and all these things, very hard. So I personally feel, there is no published record on that, but I personally feel that Scylla olivacea will be little more adapted to the environment than Scylla serrata, because Scylla serrata, a lot of disease already reported, particularly WSSB and others.
Sir Rajashekharan, what is the period of gray female availability in East Coast mangrove regions?
Almost throughout the year you can get it. And particularly this summer, this season, like, you know, what is called some rain or some little, not very cold, light cold time or summer time or any time, you can get more. But my personal experience is telling all East Coast, including Tamil Nadu, almost every time if you go in the mangrove forest area, you can get it. But here one rider is there. Nowadays, what happens, sir, because for less number of hatchery produce seed, the indiscriminate harvest or indiscriminate capture of wild seeds are going on all over India. So many places these animals are actually going wiped out because they are collecting brooders, they are collecting mothers. So they are killing actually millions of offspring. So what happening? Lots of area, they are now wiped out from this Scylla serrata species as well as Olivicia species because indiscriminate, you know, collection. So it could be get throughout the year, but except more colder time.
Thank you very much. You have answered all the questions posted by the participants. And there are many compliments and many people have thanked you for the detailed presentation. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Now, I request the convener of this international workshop and our Dean Research, madam, to kindly give her concluding remarks. Madam, please.
A very good evening to all. At the outset, I place on record my heartfelt thanks to our resource person of today's session, Dr. Anup Mandal, Project Manager, Central Aquaculture Genetics and Central Aquaculture Pathology Laboratory, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, R&D Center of EMPEDA, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, for this wonderful session on the use of molecular markers to resolve taxonomic ambiguities of species with special reference to Indian mangrove mud crabs. Molecular taxonomy is an important area because of its ability to expedite specimen identification and also to understand the species delineation. It gives us fine details of taxonomic resolution leading to more classified research. I thank the resource person, Dr. Anup Mandal, sir, for sparing his valuable time to highlight us about this very vital area, the technological advancements which will enhance the aquaculture and fisheries sector. Thank you once again, sir, for throwing light in this specific topic. We are indeed grateful for your presence and for sharing your expertise. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Dear participants, information about tomorrow's program. Tomorrow, day 5 of the 8-day international workshop. The title of the presentation is Entrepreneurial Opportunities in Aquaculture through Tilapia and Shrimp Farming by Dr. Nagamurli, Managing Director, Ulta Breams Limited, Ghana, Africa. We shall all meet at 3 p.m. sharp tomorrow. Till then, thank you. Please take care.